So I'm just going to start with a broad overview, but one of the reasons why I came to this church is because you guys value prayer so much. And Rick values prayer so much. I remember when I first met Rick, that was like something that was on his heart. I think I remember I ran into Rick at some leadership conference we were at in Atlanta, and Rick was like, I'm talking about prayer every week. And he's like, and people are telling me to stop, and I'm not stopping. And he's like, one guy, I think you said one guy asked you, when are you going to stop? And you were like, when you start praying, I'll stop talking about it. And I was like, I like this guy. That's what I want to be about. I say this a lot about Christianity, but we often want to add Christianity like it's something that we add to our lives, when Christianity is really an atomic bomb that once you bring it in, you set it off, and it destroys everything in your life and remakes something new. That's really what the Christian faith is supposed to be about. And if that's what the Christian faith is supposed to be about, that's prayer is the foundation that you rebuild that whole life on. Does that make sense? To me, this is such a sacred topic because prayer isn't something that we need to add to our faith. Without prayer, we don't have faith. Without prayer, we don't have Christianity. Without prayer, everything that we do is pointless. And so we're not talking about something that we're adding to the structure that we've built of our Christian faith. We're talking about the foundation that our Christian faith is built on. And if you don't have this foundation, then you don't have anything. And I think even using the parable that Jesus tells that this church is named after, it really is that sand, if you build your house on sand, is building your house without a prayer life. Because when the winds and the waves of this world come and beat on that house, it will fall. And I don't even think, honestly, you can engage this without prayer. Because if you don't have a prayer life, this is just stuff about God, but you don't actually know him. Does it make sense? Like in the same way that I can know stuff about you, and not know you at all. But I can know a lot of things about you. When we approach this is useless. This is just empty pages without prayer. And so the very foundation that we have to build everything on is prayer. I think the way that I say it is prayer is everything that we should do or be for a couple of reasons. One, you can't know yourself without prayer. You can't. You can't actually know who you are and what you were made to be without praying to God. God helps define you. Prayer reminds us of who we are and of whose we are. The second thing is you can't change yourself without prayer. Ultimately, we aren't what we think or believe. Ultimately, we are what we desire. And the focus of our desires, the way that we focus our desires, is through prayer. Christianity, we've made into morality in America, right? Like we've made it a moral set of laws. And if you do all of the moral set of laws, then you're a good Christian. You know, listen to Caleb, don't cuss too much, except for maybe on the freeway, right? No, I'm just kidding. Don't cuss too much. Listen to Christian music. Don't watch certain movies. Make sure you attend church regularly. Tithe, you know. Don't watch pornography. Like, as long as you fulfill this list of things, hey, you're a good Christian. But Christianity was never a set of things to do. Does that make sense? Let me say it this way. My wife and I, we have a really great marriage. And there are things that I have to do in a marriage to have a good marriage, right? Like I need to take my wife out on dates. I need to like talk to her. I need to like have time where it's just the two of us. We have to communicate about things. I have to ask her for things. She has to ask me for things. How many of you know that that's not the basis of our relationship, right? Like think of it this way. If my time with my wife was just, okay, we're going to go out on a date every week. A lot of people would say, oh, that's a good marriage, healthy marriage. You go out on a date every week. And from this time to this time, we're going to chat. And it's just you and me, nobody else. For this hour, it's just us. But after that hour, it's me time. And I'm going to do whatever I want. And I'm going to live however I want. And I'm going to go talk to whoever I want. How many of you know suddenly all of a sudden this is an unhealthy marriage, right? Meaning prayer isn't... It is something that we incorporate into the very breadth of everything that we do. It's not just something that we do once. It's not a box that we check off. We can't really know who we are or be transformed without it. The third thing is you can't know God without prayer. There is a difference between knowing things about God and knowing God. Prayer isn't a means to an end. Prayer is everything. Prayer is God's invitation to come as close to Him as we can. When we make prayer about strategy, or when we make prayer about being a formula, how many of you know oftentimes we say things like, well, we need to pray so that this happens. We need to pray so that that happens. There is truth in that. But often we miss the beauty of what prayer is supposed to be because it's actually not about that, right? Like I need to go on a date with my wife so that way we have time together, but the date isn't the point of my marriage, right? Like prayer is not a formula, it's knowing Him. It's coming as close to Him as we possibly can. It's about this one fact that God is a person, He's not a thing. God is a person, He's not an institution. God is a person, He's not a religion. God is a person, and we were made for Him. And when we connect to prayer in that way, prayer starts to become vibrant for us. The main point that I want to make today as we go through this, and I'm just going to look at the Lord's Prayer today, but the main point that I want to make today is this one point, is that prayer is not talking at God, prayer is talking with God. That sounds trite. It could sound trite, but it's actually pretty intense when you really think about how we pray. It's not talking at God. Prayer isn't saying things to Him. Prayer is talking with Him. It's having a relationship with Him. And it's not taking time. Taking time in the prayer room to sit here in silence isn't a meditative exercise. It's space to talk with God. Even just changing that one thing, doesn't that sound like that would change your prayer life in the prayer room a whole ton? Because oftentimes we show up to the prayer room, open up our Bible, we listen to the synth or the worship music that's happening, and we go, you know, we got some vibey synths that go off in here, some pads, you know, like there's some good synthesized pads that go off in here. But you could sit here and have a great atmosphere. You could have a live band and they're singing songs and they're worshiping. But if you're not treating that space as a conversation time with God, it's gonna feel like this struggle or this discipline. I used to have this youth pastor who always told us, he was a coach, he was like a jock. So like everything was, he talked to all of us teens like he was a coach all the time. So he's like, it's a discipline. You got to do it even when it's hard. You got to do it even when it sucks. You got to show up and you got to pray and you got to sit there and you got to gut it out. You got to do it over and over and over again. And it for the first part of my life, it trained me into, okay, well, I just got to do this because it's necessary. It's a discipline. And it is a discipline, but it's a discipline in the same way that going on a date and having conversations with my wife is a discipline. It's a discipline that we need to make sure we schedule it on a regular basis. But if it's just me getting through the date, how many of you know that that's not a really good date, right? Like when we sit down with God, it's the space that we're creating in our life to have a conversation where He can say things to us and we can say things to Him and we can share our hearts. We can gaze and wonder at who He is. One of the reasons why we find prayer boring is because we're boring. We show up with our boring selves, with our boring vision, and we have no plan and we have no vision for prayer at all. We just think it's a discipline that we got to gut out, and so we never find any enjoyment in it. When prayer is actually an invitation to enjoy God. So let's look at Matthew 6 here. This is when Jesus says, when they ask Jesus, teach me to pray, this is what He says. This is the Lord's Prayer. He responds, this is then how you should pray. I'm going to pause and just read it, but I want to pause through it. Our Father in heaven, holy is your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done. On earth as it is in heaven. Give to me this day my daily bread, and forgive me of my sins, as I forgive those who have sinned against me. Forgive us of our debts, and lead us not into temptation, but to deliver us from evil. Just pause again for a second on this. Our Father in heaven, holy is your name. Our Father in heaven. Sometimes it feels like I have to say that like 8 or 9 times before it actually hits me that I'm talking to God. Our Father in heaven, holy is your name. Holy is your name. Let your kingdom come. Let your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. How many of you know that this is a prayer to pray, but this is also Jesus instructing us how we approach him? It's not necessarily a prayer that when we pray, we have to pray this prayer every time. But when we pray, we want to touch every aspect of this prayer. Does that make sense? When we come to God, when we sit down in this room, when we bring our hearts before God, we want to touch each one of these things. And the first one, I'm just going to go through them because I think they're pretty self-explanatory as they are. The first one is our Father. When we come to God in prayer, it matters who we're coming to, right? We have this idea, we don't have to guess as to who God is when we come to him in prayer. We don't have to guess as to what he's feeling about us or what he's thinking about us. We don't have to guess as to whether or not we'll be welcomed or not. When we come to God, we come to him as our Father. We come to him as our, you know, it's the word Abba, which is, you know, Papa. We come to him, don't ever say Daddy God, by the way. There's like a whole movement of people in Christendom who are like, oh, Abba means Daddy. And they're like, Daddy God. It's just super weird. Please never do that. But Abba is Papa. It's the familiar word. It's Dad. There's a difference when coming to God who is inaccessible versus coming to your dad, right? My kids, I mean, especially when I was a pastor in New York, if people wanted to meet with me, just because there were so many and there was only one of me, I had, you know, my secretary, which my assistant, you're not allowed to say secretary anymore, but my assistant would schedule appointments and people would have to sit outside my office and wait to meet with me. Except for when my kids came. Whenever my kids came, it didn't matter if I was in the middle of somebody crying and sobbing and telling me their life story, my kids were allowed to bust open the door and run into my arms and go, Dad, every single time they came to my office. Why? Because they're my kids, right? There's no formalities for them. They can come in whenever they want. If they were here now, they would interrupt us filming this, but they're still my kids and I wouldn't be mad at them. Does that make sense? Because they're my children. It's my son, my daughter. When we come to God, we come to God this way every time. We don't have to sit and wrestle through, God, I'm sorry that I did this. I know you're mad at me that I haven't talked to you. I know this, I know that. Like, we wrestle with God through all of the things, but we don't actually just come to him as a father. Jesus says, when you pray, start with, he's your dad. Come to your dad. You have free access to him whenever you want, however you want. Be a confident son or daughter. Luke 11:13 says, if then you who are evil know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will your heavenly Father give you? Give the Holy Spirit to those who ask him. 1 John 3, see what kind of manner the Father has given to us that we should be called his children. See what manner of love the Father has given to us that we are called his children. See, we're not just minions. We're not just servants. He has angels. You're not praying because he needs you to serve him. We're not praying because he needs you to satisfy some sort of need for glory. You're praying because he's your Father and he loves you. And he wants to hear from his kids. So the way that we start in prayer is our Father. Come to your dad, familiar, easy access every time. And I sit and I do this every time I pray. I sit in that in seats here and I sigh and I go, Dad. And I usually have to sigh like 5 or 6 times, not as an exercise, but just to like convince my heart that that's real. Does that make sense? Like I just have to, it's almost like I have to like No, not in a routine way, Father. Wait, I gotta say it again. Dad, I'm here. And there's this, it probably takes me 3 or 4 minutes every time, but if you just pause when you come to pray to God and you start with that Father, start with Dad, start with, I'm here. I am your favorite one, your beloved. Your son is here. There's something that shifts in how you talk to him, because now you're not just going through the motions. You're not just jumping to your prayer list and I'm going to pray for Debbie because she's got gout, and I'm going to pray for Roger because, you know, he's struggling with his back. And, you know, like, a lot of times when we come to prayer, we get out our lists, we go through our stuff, and then we just get out of there. But we never actually just pause in a familiar way, open up his word and go, Dad, I'm here. I love you. Speak to me. Talk to me, right? So the first way we come to God when we pray is our Father. The second way we come to God is, holy is your name. Americans are really bad at this one. And here's why. Because we live in a democratic government. And so I feel like we always talk to God like we get to vote on his leadership. Does that make sense? When we come to God in prayer, we talk to him like we get to elect the kind of God that we want. Like we, I like this policy, but I don't like this policy. I like this part of your word, I don't like this part of your word. I feel like we approach him like he's a democratic elected official. But instead, what we need to do when we come to God, it's Dad, it's Father, but there's this reverence that my Dad is God. And he is, whether I want him to be or not, he is what he is, and I don't have a say in any of his ways or who he is. I have no say. My Dad is the creator of the heavens and the earth. And so there's this familiar, right? He's your Dad. But then there's this reverence of, he is holy. And so I think the two are so important when you come to the prayer room to pray. My Father, Dad, I'm here. I have access, right? Like my kids running into my office. But how many of you know my kids still have to acknowledge my authority when they come into my office, right? Because I run in whenever I want, but my Dad's in control. And this is his office, and this is his world. And I'm going to respect him when I come before him. Does that make sense? It's my Father, he's familiar, and I have free access to his throne whenever I want, but he is holy, and I need to appreciate his holiness. And I also pause on this one for a while when I pray it, when I start in prayer, because I want to pause on, holy is your name. Your name is holy. This is both something to have fear and trembling about, but this is also something to have confidence in, right? Holy is your name. God, the world feels out of control. You are in control. I feel like everything's spinning all around me. You are holy. Thank you, God. So we come to him both as our Dad, and then we come to him as holy. And the third way is, we join him in his mission statement. God's mission statement is, his gospel is, let my kingdom come. That's his goal. It's literally in Isaiah. Where is it? I can't remember. Oh well. Isaiah 52:7. How beautiful upon the mountains are the feet of those who bring good news and happiness, who publishes salvation, who says to Zion, your God reigns. God's mission statement is that he will reign. The gospel summed up in three words is, your God reigns. And when we pray, we aren't asking for our will or what our version is of what we think needs to happen. We come to our Dad who is holy, and we join his plans. Does that make sense? Prayer is, this is what I mean by, no, we're not talking at God, we're talking with God. We're joining his will in the earth. And his will looks very different than my will. And his plan looks very different than your plan or my plan or some preacher out there's plan, right? His plan is very different because his mission statement is that his kingdom is going to come. And he's going to accomplish that in a way that's probably going to feel unorthodox to us. He's probably going to establish his kingdom where in the middle of establishing it, and it feels like this right now in our world, where we're going, God, do you know what you're doing? Because it looks crazy out here. Instead of asking for the right person to get elected or the right person to get judged or this happen or that happen, we literally pause in prayer and we say, I'm going to join what you're doing because you know what you're doing. Let your kingdom come. Let your will, not mine, be done. And we join him in prayer. And we ask him, and you can ask him questions, and you can be mad at God. There's things that I'm mad about often. I'm like, why did that happen? Why does this have to happen? Why does that have to happen? And I think, honestly, and I'm going to say this in a different message, but when we pray to God, we want to talk to God honestly. Does that make sense? In truth. You know who was the most honest prayer in the world? Was David. Have you read the Psalms? God, my enemies have surrounded me. Everyone's out to get me. Everyone's trying to come against me. Why are they doing this, God? And he prayed with honesty. Oftentimes we don't pray honestly to our dad, who's holy. But we want to come and we want to join his will. We want to attribute ourselves to his will when we pray. This matters in intercession too. Intercession is not informing God of what's wrong with our world. When we're praying for the ending of abortion, God's not going, wait, time out, pause. Gabriel, you never told me that that's happening in America. The abortion thing, that's still going on? Thank you for letting me know. I'm going to do something about it now. Like when we pray for the ending of human trafficking, when we pray for, you know, Uncle Rob's shoulder to get healed, he's not like, whoa, Robert, a shoulder? I had no idea. Really? Like which one? The right or the left one? Because, you know, I can't tell. Like God knows exactly what's happening in Rob's shoulder, right? When we pray, we're not informing God, we're joining God. Does that make sense? There's a difference that happens. And when we see that difference, it makes all the difference in the world in our prayer life because we suddenly don't feel the need to have to use as many words when we're praying to God. He doesn't need every word to be spoken because he knows, he loves it. If you come to God and you just pray a lot of words, he's not mad at you. He's like, hey, that's my one kid that talks a lot. He's not mad about it. He's like, so-and-so, just they love to talk. They just talk all the time. But he would love it if you would pause for a second and let him get a word in. Does it make sense? When we pray, we would hear God more if we talked a lot less when we pray. We think prayer requires words. Prayer is the posturing of our hearts to join his will. Let your kingdom come, let your will be done. Now, the next part of the prayer goes into petition. This is, you'll notice the first three things Jesus tells us to do and pray have nothing to do with asking him for stuff, right? It has nothing to do with informing him about our needs. The first thing, three things that we do when we sit down to pray are acknowledge who he is, our relationship, that he is our dad. To honor him in his position, that his way goes. We love God on God's terms, not our terms. And so we honor him as holy. And then we ask for his kingdom to come and his will be done. And then we switch to petition. We go, Father, give me today my daily bread. I need help. And you know what else? More than help, what you're acknowledging when you pray this part of the prayer is you're acknowledging that your provision doesn't come from you, it comes from him. I didn't make this money. He provided this money. Continue to provide for me, God. When you have anxiety about what you need or the bills that you have to pay or the taxes that you have to pay, you can pause and go, Father, give to me my daily bread, because everything that I have comes from you anyway. So we pray, give us our daily bread. And then the next thing that we pray is we ask God for forgiveness. Notice that it's almost at the end of the prayer that we've finally gotten to the part where most of us start. Oh God, I'm such a sinner. Like, I feel like most prayer times and worship times, I spend the first 10 minutes going, I shouldn't have watched that movie last night. That was stupid. I shouldn't have said that thing to so-and-so. God, forgive me for blah, blah, blah. Oh, I'm such an idiot. God, it's been like 2 days. You know, I was supposed to come here yesterday, but I skipped the prayer room. And do you guys know what I'm talking about? Like, you start every prayer time with this list of all of the ways that you've messed up, asking him for forgiveness. But notice that he doesn't even have you do that until the end. Because before you come to him, he wants you to come without shame. He wants you to acknowledge who you are, that you're a son no matter what you did. You're a daughter no matter what you've done. You're his kid. He loves you and he's holy. He's in control and his will is all powerful. And he's going to provide everything for you. When you ask for forgiveness in that context. God, forgive me of my sins. Dad, I messed up. Help me. Forgive me. And then when you ask him for forgiveness, you also acknowledge the status of your friends and those around you and the people in your world, that they are just as in need of your dad as you are, because they're also his kids. And so you pray, God, forgive them as you've forgiven me. And then lastly, he says to pray, keep me from temptation. And I don't feel like this is a prayer we often pray, but I feel like it's a prayer we really need to pray. It's a way that we need to approach our prayer life on a regular basis, which is, God, help me see where I could be heading in the wrong direction. Not, I'm in the wrong direction right now. I haven't done the thing yet, but help me see before it happens. Give me grace to never leave your sight. Let me see it before it happens, God, because I don't want to do anything that would disrupt this relationship, right? Nothing, God, that hinders this relationship. I don't want any of it in between you or me, so keep me from temptation and deliver me from the evil one who would ensnare me. What's one of the coolest things to me is that this prayer is perfect. And I think, you know, God's God, he's cool, he knows what he's doing. When you think about the end times and you think about trouble coming into a nation, when you think about trouble coming to the world, this prayer is the perfect prayer to pray, right? When there's uncertainty in our nation, this prayer is the perfect prayer to pray. Because we acknowledge that he's our dad and he loves us and he's not gonna have anything bad happen to us. We acknowledge that he's holy and he knows what he's doing and he's in control. We acknowledge that it's his will, not ours anyway. He knows the end of the story and it's all going to work out. And in the process, he's gonna provide for us, even if it gets so bad that the Antichrist is in power and we can't buy or sell. Isn't that amazing? Even if it gets to the point where the church, persecution comes to the church in America, where we can't receive tithes anymore and we no longer have a building and they take everything away from us, somehow he has a provision in there that he's going to provide for us anyway. He's going to forgive us of our sins. He's going to help us carry our hearts in a way that we forgive others of their sins. And he's going to keep us from the evil one and he's going to keep us from temptation. I think that that's pretty amazing. God, in the way that Jesus laid this out for us, he laid out for us how we approach God. Over the next the rest of these sessions, I'm going to have a lot of like prayer exercises, so we'll be praying a lot more. The next one, I'll probably be doing some teaching. But the way that I wanted to start off this, when we think about coming to the prayer room, is I wanted to start off like, what do you do when you sit in the chair for the very first time? What do you do when you come in here, the synth is playing, and you have a Bible and a journal? Where do you start? And you start here with the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, does anybody else do that? You like revert back to the King James all of a sudden? I never say art ever. Our Father who in heaven, holy is your name. We approach him as our dad, and we approach him as he's holy. So I want to pray right now. Holy Spirit, we thank you for your leadership. We thank you, God, that you are our dad, that you love us, that we're not minions, we're not servants, we're not objects for you to control or just heartlessly rule over, but Father, we're your children that you love. We're your beloved children, beloved sons, beloved daughters. Holy is your name, God. You are holy. You are high. Father, we say, let your kingdom come. Let your will be done, God, in our world, in our lives, in our marriages, in our homes, in our day-to-day, God. We build our life around your life. We don't ask you, Father, to come build or to join ours, but we join yours. Father, we pray, would you provide for us? Father, we pray that you would forgive us where we faltered. And forgive others, Father, who have faltered against us. And Father, would you keep us in your ways and keep us from the evil one? Because we don't want to leave your presence. Build our lives around your presence, Father. In Jesus' name, amen. So what I want to do just for the next like 10, 15 minutes, if we can, is like put on worship music. But I'd love to just have our Bibles out, Matthew 6, and take some time to really go on a journey through the prayer of the Lord's Prayer, where we start with our Father, and sit there for as long as you can. Like, you don't move on from it quick. Sit there for a while and contemplate God being our Father, and then move on to each one and really let each reality hit our hearts and just see where the Lord takes us for the next little bit. We're gonna do that, and then we can end.